Here we go. I want to lift my hands higher than before. I want to sing a little louder than before. I want to scream louder than before, yeah. I want to shout louder, yeah. Come on and say, freedom, freedom. Oh, Lord, I thank you for freedom. Hey.
Lord, prepare to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. And with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary. And with thanksgiving, I'll be a living sanctuary for you, yeah. Lord, prepare me, yeah. Pure and holy before you, tried and true, and with thanksgiving. I'll be a living sanctuary for you. Help me tell him, yeah. Yeah. Yes to your will, Lord. Yes to your way. Yes, I'll obey. Yeah. Whatever you want me to do, Lord. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. Put your help me tell him, mold me where you want me to be. Mold me where you want me to be. Say, mold me where you want me to be. I said, mold me where you want me to be. Where you want me to go. How you want me to go. Where you want me to be. How you want me to be. Where you want me to go. How you want me to go. Where you want me to go. How you want me to go. And we'll say yeah. Yes to your will. Say yeah, yeah. Yes to your way. Say yeah. Yes to your will. Say yeah, yeah. Yes to your way. Say yes, I'll obey. Yes to your way. Yes to your will. Yes every day. Yes, I'll obey. Yes to your way. Yes to your will. Yes every day. And we'll say yeah, yeah. Yes to your will. Say yeah, yeah. Yes to your way. We'll say yeah, yeah. Yes to your will. Say yeah. Lord, prepare to be a
Church, amen. Amen. If you're excited about Jesus, come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Amen. This morning, for our inspirational nuggets this morning, I had the youth in mind this morning and felt led to go to Proverbs chapter 3, beginning at verse 5. Where it says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Verse 7 says, be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. And this being Youth Sunday, and even though it's Youth Sunday, there's a message in here for the grown folks as well. But the text says, lean not to thine own understanding. And every parent who has had that preteen to become a teenager, and as they get ready to graduate high school, most of us thought we had life figured out. Only 17, only 18, but we know already. But the text tells us to lean not to thine own understanding. And as a child of God, we should always seek the Lord first. Now, granted, if you were raised in a Christian home and you followed your mother and father and grandparents' instructions, well, you know, we've got some understanding. But we don't know enough to take this world on thinking that we know everything and we got it all figured out and we don't need anybody's help. And the text says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him. And being a grown man now, I can look back over my own life. Having had the instruction, having had the teaching, I just wish I would have done what Daddy said. In so many situations, I wish I would have did what Mama said. Yeah. In so many situations, because it wasn't like the teaching wasn't there. But I was that teenager, I thought, look, I got this. I can figure this out. If I get into a jam, I can get myself out. You know, had that headstrong attitude. Now, let me say this. Some of the young people are gone out of the room. But listen, out of all of the dirt I did as a child, y'all catch this right here. The one thing I never did was disrespect my mother and father.
All right.
Now, I raised some hell around the corner and did some stuff up the street, but I never talked back to mama, raised my voice to mom and daddy, didn't do it. Now, that's one thing I'm not going to have to give an account for when I stand before him. Now, I got a long list of other things, but when it come down to respecting Arthur and Gene, listen, I didn't give them that problem. So, young people, one thing I just really want you to get out of this, you know, just keep God first in your life. You know, we're at a time now where it's a lot going on. It's a lot more going on with teenagers now than it was even in my day. And I'm only 45 years old. Now, when you think about social media and the internet and Google, you can, anything that they want to even, the first thing, the farthest thing from their mind, you can just Google it and it's right there. They got access to stuff we didn't have access to. And we need to be praying for them. Because, listen, when they get out from under your wing, when they get out the nest, this is a different world than when we were coming along. But the thing about it, God hadn't changed. And if we teach them, see, here's the thing, y'all. It's time for the parents to have some faith also. It says, train a child up in the way that he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. So even though they may take a different avenue, go to the right or to the left. If you've taught them right, you got to trust God with them.
Yes, sir.
Now, I know my mama stayed up late worried about her son. I think I told y'all before that she had that police scanner. Her and my grandma would be up at midnight listening just in case, you know, they gave the description of the car I was driving or something. But listen, if you can just trust God, even though that child may go and do some things totally different than how you've raised them, still love them and trust God with them.
Yes, sir.
Don't get yourself sick and stressed out over decisions that are things they choose to do. Now, you can, of course, we're going to be concerned about our kids, and if there's something they get into that, you know, that you can't help but love them and be concerned with them. But listen, if they choose something, well, you just got to love them. You can still give them advice.
Yeah.
You can still teach them, but ultimately they're going to do what they want to do.
Reverend.
But as a parent, just trust God with them.
Yes,
Because, see, you never know how God is building up their testimony. Because since I've come back to the Lord, I've had to tell my testimony of some things the Lord brought me out of. Well, listen, as a parent, we don't want our children to go through it. But see, it may be God's will for them to go through it so they can come back and tell somebody about it. So trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not to thine own understanding. Young people, you don't know it all. You don't know it all. Be wise and listen.
Yeah, man.
Please don't have that flippant attitude. You know, don't talk back to mom and them. You know, they're a little older, but they'll still pop you. Don't do that. You know what I'm saying? Just trust in the Lord and be wise. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Listen, you can save yourself a whole lot of heartache and pain. Trust me, you can save yourself some heartache and pain by just trying to live right. You're not going to be perfect. You're going to make some mistakes. And as adults, we know that. You're going to make some mistakes. But there are some mistakes can be avoided just by trying to do the right thing. So do the right thing, trust God, and lean not to thine own understanding.
Oh, Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Whenever I think about how good God has been to me, for some strange reason, water starts to come out of my eyes. I stopped trying to stop it a long time ago. Now think about it. I'm a big man. I got big hands. But there's only so much I can hold. There's only so much I can handle. If you've never tried, I dare you right now to put it all in his hand. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Ah, glory to God. Hallelujah. Woo. Glory to God. Ah. Mm. I was just sitting there thinking about how good it is to be here. I think of other places I could be. I could be in a hospital somewhere. I could be in a penitentiary somewhere. Glory to God, hallelujah. Oh, Lord God. It's preaching time. It's preaching time. Would you please stand for a short word of prayer? Father God in heaven, Father our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, Lord God, first of all, thank you so much. Thank you, Lord, just for being God and being God all by yourself, Lord. Lord God, I ask right now in the name of Jesus for preaching power. Lord, we talked about this last night. Lord, I just pray that you would just use this old hood cat, Lord God, for your glory. Lord, I pray that they don't see me, but they see you, Lord God. I pray that they don't hear me, but they hear you, Lord God. Speak, Lord, as only you know how. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. First of all, of course, giving honor to God. He's the reason we're all here right now. He woke us all up, woke us up this morning. He gave us grace and mercy. And for that, I say, Lord, thank you. I want to give double honor to my pastor for this opportunity. Thank you so much, Pastor, for this privilege to stand and preach God's word. In respect to my brother, the brethren of the clergy, deacons, mothers, guests, members, everybody, just thank God for you all. This morning, the Lord sent me, I had other stuff that I thought I was gonna do, and it didn't work out. So what God had me to tell you this morning, well, actually, he wants us to go to Philippians. The chapter is 4. I'm going to read verses 1 through 7. But I want us to focus mostly on verses 6 through 7. Philippians 4, I'm going to read verses 1 through 7. And it reads, therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Eudaeus, and I beseech Syntyche, that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also and with other my fellow laborers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Verse 6 says, be careful for nothing, but in everything, everybody say everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. Verse 7 says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. For a preaching topic this morning, I want to talk about don't pray and worry. Don't pray and worry. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Thank you, Lord. In this fourth chapter of Philippians, Paul has written a letter to the church of Philippi. The reason for him writing this letter, he had a few reasons, but some of the reasons were he wanted this letter to encourage the church. He wanted the church to stay unified in the Lord. He also wanted to encourage the church to support one another, to help one another. Paul also wanted to thank them for supporting him. He also wanted to maintain a relationship with the church. And finally, he wrote this letter because he couldn't be there. Some say he was in prison. Some say he was confined to house arrest. But needless to say, he could not be here, be there.
Yes, sir.
So he sent a letter.
A letter.
It was very important. So he sent a letter. Now, it's safe to say that everyone here today is going through something. We all have various issues. Some are financial. Some have health issues. Some have marital issues. Some dealing with habits that they're trying to get rid of. Some have children or other family issues.
Yeah, preacher.
But we all have issues.
Yeah.
Like my holy homeboy says, I got a thing.
Yeah.
You got a thing. We all got a thing.
Yeah.
Fact of the matter is, someone may be so stressed out right now that you're thinking about giving up and throwing in the towel. Somebody may be thinking, don't push me because I'm close to the edge. I'm trying not to lose my head. It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under. Y'all can Google that. See, we must be careful not to focus too much on the problem. Because by doing so, we may lose focus on the problem solver. See, God wants us to totally trust him. Have total faith in him. Church is a very dangerous thing not to totally trust God. See, because if you're not totally trusting God, that means you're trusting something or somebody else. Brothers and sisters, when we fail to totally trust God and have total faith in him, that makes sin more appealing.
Yes, sir.
See, we try to handle it our way. We think we have the best solution. But let me tell you something about our thoughts. If you go to Isaiah 55, go down to 8 and 9, it says, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. We have to trust him. Because if we don't trust him, we'll start trying to make things happen ourselves. We'll start trying to take the shortcut, the short road. Try to make that quick, fast money. We have to trust him. See, the best thing for us to do is go to God in prayer. Go to God in prayer. Make your request known unto God. Be specific and be on the lookout for your answer. Be on the lookout for your blessing. I would be a fool to ask pastor a question or ask pastor for something and not look for his response. Especially if I, you know, need to borrow about $2 or $3. You know, and I ask pastor for $2 or $3, I need to, I'm going to be watching to see what he's going to do. Yeah. Now, be on the lookout for your blessing and your answer. Now, honestly, God may answer you in one of three ways. One may be a yes, one may be a no, and the other one may be not yet. Trust God, church.
Yeah, preacher.
Don't pray and worry. Back over to Philippians, verse 6. It reads, be careful for nothing. Now that word careful, that doesn't mean don't be concerned. It just means don't be overly concerned. Don't be too concerned that you can't sleep at night. Don't be too concerned that you can't do the things that God has called you to do. In other words, that word careful means don't get distracted. Don't get distracted. See, because when you get distracted, that'll keep you from doing what God wants you to do. You remember what happened to Peter, don't you? Jesus was on the lake, and the disciples were terrified. And Peter said, Lord, if it's you, bid me to come. So Jesus said, come. Now, on his way to Jesus, Peter got distracted.
Yes, sir.
He got distracted by the storm that was going on. It'd be safe to say that everybody in here is either in one, been in one, or coming out of one.
Yes, sir.
But don't get distracted. Stay focused on Jesus. Don't let the storm cause you to sink. Don't let it cause you to sink. Stay focused.
Yes,
sir. So number one is, don't get distracted. Y'all got that? Number two is, pray. It says, but in everything by prayer and supplication, pray. Pray about the big stuff. Pray about the little stuff. Pray when you're happy. Pray when you're sad. Pray when you're hungry. Pray when you're full. Pray when you're broke. And pray when you got money. But in everything, by prayer and supplication. That word supplication is defined as the action of asking or begging for something seriously and humbly. See, sometimes we get on our knees and we come to God about something and we're not serious at all. We're not humble at all. We want to tell God what to do. Tell him how to do it. Tell him when to do it. Be humble in your prayer. Make your prayer specific. So, number one is, don't get discouraged. I mean, don't get distracted. Number two is pray. Not only do we pray, but it says to pray with thanksgiving.
Yes, sir.
So since that with is there, that lets me know that prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving all go together. We got to be, see, we get so caught up in what we don't have Sometimes we don't thank God for what we do have. We complain about going to the same job that we prayed and asked God for.
Yes, sir.
We have to be more thankful. We have to live a life of thankfulness. I teach my children to be thankful for whatever, because first of all, nobody has to be nice to you. You do know that, right? So we need to be thankful when somebody does something for you. Show some gratitude. Because sometimes that may not be right, but I'm the kind of person, hey, if I do something for you and I give you something and you act like you don't appreciate it, it might not be right, but you may not get it again. I'm just being real. When I was a kid, you know how you go from the stage of the tricycle to the 20-inch bike to the 10-speed? Well, I wanted a 10-speed so bad when I was a kid. And my mama said, well, why would I buy you a 10-speed if you don't take care of the little bike? You act like you're not thankful for the small things. So why would I bless you with bigger things? With thanksgiving. Be thankful.
Be thankful, Reverend.
Be thankful. Verse 6 also says, let your request be known unto God. Your request. You know, I don't knock nobody for what they do. It's a lot of people that they want to speak everything. They want to decree everything. They want to just everything except ask God. God said, make your request known. In other words, He already knows what you need.
Yeah.
He knows that. He's God. But he still wants you to ask. He still wants. Your children just can't do whatever they want to do. You know what they need. You know what they want. But you still want them to come to you and ask. Amen?
Yes,
sir. Let your request be known unto God. See, somebody's been praying, but they hadn't been specific with their prayer. Somebody is praying, Lord, send me a husband. Lord, send me a wife. Lord, bless me with a job. Well, don't you know that if you just settle for anything, that just may be what you get?
Reach up.
You got to be specific. Lord knows what you like. You might like them tall. You might like them short. You might like them dark. You might like them light. Make your request known. Be specific.
Yeah, preacher.
Don't just take anything. If we were to go out and eat, I like my steaks medium rare. Some people like them well done. Now, if you ordered your steak well done, that was your request. You asked the waiter for a well done steak. And sometimes 30 minutes later, they come back with a steak and you cut it open and blood is running out of it. Are you going to keep it and eat it? No, you're going to send it back. Because that's not what you asked for. See, we got to stop accepting just anything. Make your request known. Be specific. Number one, don't get distracted. Number two, pray. Number three, be specific with your request. Now we move on to number four. Number four, be obedient. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, it says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive them, and will forgive their sin, and will heal their land. How many good parents are going to bless your child and they don't do anything you tell them to do? That don't make sense. They haven't done anything. They don't keep it. They won't clean their room. They won't wash the dishes when you tell them. But on Christmas time, you want to shower them with all kind of blessings. That confuses the child because they're thinking, well, I ain't got to do what mama or daddy tells me to do. They're going to give it to me anyway. Well, God, yeah, he will bless you with what you need, but there are some other things that we may want, that we may desire. But how do you know if you're not in position, if you're not where God told you to be, you're going to miss out on that? I heard a pastor years ago use the analogy of a football game. He used the analogy of a quarterback and a wide receiver. He says the quarterback tells the wide receiver what route to run. The wide receiver may have to run 20 steps front to the front and then 20 steps to the right, and then circle back, and whatever the pattern is that the quarterback told him to do or told him to run, that's what he has to do. Because, see, a lot of times, before he even gets to where he's supposed to be,
yes,
the quarterback has already released that ball or that blessing. He's already thrown it. And as long as the running back is where he's supposed to be at the right time,
yes,
in the right place, he is set up to catch that blessing.
Yes, sir. Yeah, preacher. Yeah, Reverend. Yeah.
Got to be obedient.
Yes, sir.
When God says do this, do that. Be obedient. How many of you know that obedience is better than sacrifice? So number one is don't get distracted. Number two is pray. Number three is be specific with your request. And number four is be obedient. Now number five, it should be something that we should just know this anyway, but sometimes we don't have it. And number five is you need to have faith. Have faith. Hebrews 11:6 says, but without faith it is impossible to please him.
Yes,
for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him.
Yes.
Have faith. Whatever you're going through. Why would you ask God for something and not believe that he can do it?
Amen.
Or that he will do it? See, we get caught up on he's able, but there's another side, and that is he will. But you got to have faith. You got to believe that. Sometimes you have more faith, Pastor, in a roll of toilet paper than we do God.
Yeah.
Than we do Jesus Christ.
Talk, Reverend.
You know what I'm talking about. Sometimes you go there and you just take for granted it's there. It's been there. But today it's not there. We ought to have more faith in God than we do in a roll of toilet paper, church.
Gotcha.
Number one, don't get distracted. Number two, pray. Number three, be specific with your request. Number four, be obedient. Number five, have faith. That brings us to number six. Be patient. Be patient. Patience is a virtue. Can you imagine the things that we would get ourselves into if we did not have patience? You know that person that you've been praying about? God hadn't given you an answer. Or maybe he has given you an answer. Maybe he said no. Maybe he said not yet. But you get impatient. And you're going to try to make that thing work anyway. A year down the line, you praying to get out of that thing. Be patient. Don't just take anything. Don't you know that everything that is that's good comes from the Lord?
Yes, sir.
Everything that's good. God is not going to give you some mess. You didn't ask for mess. Why should you take mess? Be patient. Be patient.
Yeah, preacher.
Verse 7 reads, and I'm almost finished. It says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. That word keep, if you will look and see what it is translated in the Greek, it means guard. In other words, the peace of God will guard your heart and your mind. You wonder why you haven't lost your mind? It's the peace of God. You want to know, your heart's been broken before plenty of times, but you're still here. Your heart is still ticking. You want to know why? It's the peace of God. God is keeping your heart and he is keeping your mind. The peace of God. What are you talking about? How can you have that type of peace? The peace that surpasses all understanding. Well, see, once you realize, yeah, you're on your way to hell. Once you realize that you had a sin debt that you could not pay. Once you realize that it was on a Friday when they took him and they placed him on the cross. Once you realize that they took nails and put them in his hands and in his feet. Once you realize they placed a crown of thorn on his head. Once you realize that they beat him until his back just bursted open with blood and his bones were showing. Once you realize that he did all that for you, that ought to give you some peace. Well, once you realize that he did die, but once you come to the realization that it was 3 days later, that he got up with all power in his hand, that ought to give you some peace. Because see, when he got up, he didn't get up empty-handed. He got up with some power. He got up with some faith. He got up with your patience. Everything that you needed not to worry, God has it.
Yes, sir.
Jesus Christ has it. Once you realize that he got up early Sunday morning, that ought to give you some peace. Praise the church, don't pray and worry. That just don't make sense to pray and worry. Trust God. Have faith in God. Don't get distracted. Be patient. Be obedient. And if God says no, praise him for no.
Amen, amen. Let's follow the preacher's instruction if you're going to pray. Don't even much worry about it if you're going to pray. If you pray, just go home. With the right faith, you go home and enjoy right now what's on the way. Anybody ever enjoys what's on the way? I say you can enjoy what's on the way. Amen. Thank you, Campbell. Amen. Job well done. There may be someone here this morning who have not accepted Christ as your Savior. If you are here this morning, amen, today can be your day. It can be your hour, amen. You didn't just accidentally show up here on today. It's because of God's providential plan that you are here today. So let us stand all over the building. Let us stand. Miss Kim ministered to us through music. Amen.
A wonderful change.
If there be one,
has come over me.
Will you come? Will you trust him?